that everybody here can easily understand.
Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth?
What? Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you.
What we got here is a failure to communicate.
Welcome to the Uncommon Communicator Podcast. Your hosts, James Gable and Brandon Thompson, are here to bring you enlightenment to the topic of communication.
Good afternoon,
Brandon. Yes, welcome back, James.
Hey, thank you.
Where have you been?
I have been at the Toastmasters International Convention in Nashville, Tennessee.
How was Tennessee?
Man, it was a blast. We didn't see much of it. We stayed at the Gaylord Opryland Resort, and you didn't have to leave it. It was gorgeous.
No. It was. We had a. There was a resort in Mexico. We felt the same way. It was like right off the beach. And we're like, well, we scheduled other things, but we didn't have to. All right. So, what did you do at this Toastmasters convention?
We received a training for our district roles.
Okay.
Which that was the first part of the week, and then the second part was a convention. There was some training, keynote speakers. They gave away a golden gavel to an individual who
a gavel.
So every year, one individual gets the golden gavel. They're not necessarily a Toastmaster, but they're people that represent communication and speaking.
Okay.
Stephen Covey has been a recipient of it. There's been lots of different recipients, and this individual is really. She wrote the book. DEI for Dummies, Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion.
Okay.
And she really spoke to that topic. So she was a receiver of the golden gavel, and then you see the new leadership. So it was just a lot of fun.
Is it actually a golden gavel?
I didn't see if it's made of real gold.
No, but like, is it just a
it's thing? In a plaque, and they actually receive a gavel.
Yeah. And they get a gavel. Yeah. Right. Oh, yeah. Do they get to carry it around for the rest of the time?
It's apparently really heavy. Either that or she doesn't work out.
She doesn't work out.
She was like, whoa, this is really heavy.
Do you even lift, bro? The answer is apparently not. Okay. All right. So someone got a golden gavel. We had fun at the communication convention.
It was a blast.
Right. All right. You could sound more convincing when you say that.
It was a blast.
There you go.
No, it was so much fun. Networking. I met people from all over the world. Communicating with, I had lunch with some fellows from India. Mm-hmm. And they're, you know, what they're doing with their Toastmasters clubs in India is really some neat stuff. And I met people from Australia, people from the Bahamas. It was
Aussies.
Just a lot of fun. A lot of our region, we're in region District 26, Region 4, are from Canada.
Mm.
So spoke with a lot of Canadians.
A.
Well, anyways, it's good to be back. I couldn't wait to get back and talk about the Uncommon Communicator.
Mm-hmm. I wholeheartedly agree. All right, James. So what's the conversation today?
I thought we would talk about eye contact and how important this is in communication. I did some man on the street interviews, so you'll see some of those on LinkedIn if you follow us there. And I did talk to the individual from the Bahamas, and she talked about maintaining that eye contact and then really kind of sent me down this rabbit hole of really trying to see how deep does that type of nonverbal communication go.
Mm-hmm.
And it's pretty amazing. Like, there's some cultural things that we're going to talk about. There's a whole psychology of eye contact, as well as we're going to give you some tips at the end. But it is really as important, that form of nonverbal communication, as anything else that you do nonverbally when you're having a conversation with somebody.
Yeah. It's also just kind of weird because you always, I don't know, you make eye contact when you like look at somebody. It's been like, that sounds so stupid, but like, if you're just looking at somebody from across the room, the first thing you're going to do is like look at their eyes. You're not necessarily looking back at you, but the first thing you do is you look at their eyes.
Yeah. And that's so looking at that psychology of that as well, too. When you walk in a room and you know somebody and other people are doing their thing and they see you and you make that eye contact across the room, you're communicating across the room without any words.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I see you.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes you wave. I was like, sometimes you wave, sometimes you don't have to, but like, maybe you notice the wave first and immediately after that, it's like eye contact. It's weird.
You went to the school in the 80s like I did. All you need is the head nod.
It is the head nod.
Yeah,
the up, not the down.
Yeah,
but not the sound.
That's always
yeah.
Up. Sup.
Yeah, the head down's like, good day, sir.
Good day, sir. You're from England.
Yeah,
no, but when the 90s in California or the 80s, sup.
So, you know, head's always a hello and the down's always good day, sir.
That's right.
Yeah. That was always a phone. All right. So what is the importance of eye contact in communication?
Yeah, and I think there are really five things that stand out for me that is why eye contact is so important. Eye contact opens and closes your communications. You're going to start with it. You're going to end with it. Sometimes you might not do it in the middle. Sometimes you might, you know, do it appropriately, and we're going to talk a little bit about that. But it opens and closes your communications. It's the initial nonverbal that you do to start a conversation.
Mm-hmm. It's also weird too to sit next to somebody. You always like start the like it's the same thing. You start and you look at each other in the eyes, and then like as the conversation goes, you'll be looking every other which way, but like necessarily at each other if you're sitting side by side, and then you always close it out with eye contact.
Yeah, it's very important to do, but it is not easy.
No.
And it's really difficult for some people and some cultures, but we're going to talk about that in a minute. Now, increasing your eye contact is associated with credibility. Mm-hmm. You know, you are saying that you're confident, you're credible, but also emits a level of dominance, potentially, in how you do it and how you are either staring at somebody or making that eye contact. It does emit a level of dominance or is associated with it.
As it turns out, staring somebody down can be intimidating.
Very.
And or just staring at somebody in general. They think you're going to need something. They think you want something from them, or like you're trying to get their... Again, because we just established that, right? You're trying to get someone's attention. One of the first things you do is you just make eye contact. Or right. If you're trying to find somebody, the first thing you do is make eye contact. So if you just start making eye contact with random people, they're like, what you want?
They're gonna make that conversation come out, right? Like, what are you up about?
I was like, okay. You've clearly gone out of your way to get my attention. So what do you want?
There's even some studies that have shown if somebody is staring at you, you're not making eye to eye contact, mm-hmm. but they're watching you. You can know if they're watching you because they'll mimic what you do. Like you know, everybody mimics the yawn. You see a yawn, you're gonna yawn. Mm-hmm. You can yawn and see if they yawn to know if they've been watching you that whole time. Really neat psychology trip. Don't do it.
We've already talked about yawning. Well, that was one of my favorite like episodes of Mythbusters, was that like yawns actually are contagious.
Completely.
Don't know why, but they are. It's a psychological game, as they say. All right. And a lack of eye contact and blinking are interpretive as submissive. This is true. Like, especially when you look down, right? A lot of it is looking down.
It seems to always be down instead of up and away or something, right?
Yeah, like you're showing, like, the crown of your head or whatever. It's almost, mm-hmm. It probably stems from, like, bowing. When you would bow to somebody, right? Like, you would show the top part of your head. Wolves and dogs will do it. Same kind of a thing, right? And, you know, they'll stare. When they're combative, they'll stare each other down. Otherwise, they'll divert the eyes down.
Yeah, and that's even some stuff they talk about when approaching like a dog. An aggressive dog is to not maintain that eye contact because mm-hmm. that dog will be looking for that eye contact. But they found with dogs and animals as well, too, they will maintain that bonding through people that they care about through eye contact.
Yep.
My dog stare at me all the time. He's not trying to kick my butt. He's 17 pounds. What's he got, right? What's he got on me? Mm-hmm. But there is that eye contact, but you want to be careful around animals because they will take it as aggressive. You want to avert your eyes for stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But that submissive idea is interesting to me as well, too, because it really shows that in some cultures, that's kind of talked about that way.
Yeah.
Right?
All right. And then high-status people are looked at and look more while talking than listening to, which is also, that's the other hard part, too, is like when you're talking to somebody, you have to like hold some kind of an eye contact or like look at them or look at their general way to create the conversation. And then after that, to know somebody's listening, eye contact is a key. Otherwise, you know, they're staring or fiddling or something else. How are they really paying attention?
Or looking at their phone.
Phone, yeah.
Yeah, I famously had a conversation with somebody, and they were one of those, I'm going to talk until I run out of words, and then I need to check my phone. And then they're talking, you know, maintaining eye contact and hands and all that. And then it's like, they'll ask like a bogus, so what do you think about, you know, cheese? And because they know I'm going to talk about that. And then the minute I did that was right to the phone, checking emails and stuff.
Just get the conversation off of them.
So yeah, that way they can go do their thing, which that is just an aversion to that conversation. That's mm-hmm. a conversation killer. Some people don't notice it, but that is absolutely a conversation killer. And the last one is stares communicate hostility. So we're not talking just eye contact. We're talking staring. Mm-hmm. And I shared with you a TikTok video that I had seen where this guy, and we do not recommend this. Do not attempt this. This is done by professionals. But they were staring
professional at TikTokers.
Yeah. Well, he probably makes more money than you and I. So he's a professional TikToker. But he would
see the receipts.
He would stare down gang members. That's what they called it. Not all of them looked like gang members. Some clearly were. But he would just stare at them. No words. But he was definitely aggressive. And they got up into his face.
They got very agitated.
Pushed him, grabbed him, all without 100% nonverbal communication. But with that stare.
Yeah. He wouldn't say anything. He wouldn't, you know, sometimes he'd back away, sometimes he wouldn't. But yeah, same kind of thing.
But what did you catch? He raised an eyebrow.
Yeah, he would.
Doesn't that shout in nonverbal?
No. He's holding eye contact and making faces at him. Like, gee, I wonder why somebody thinks you're being funny. Like, not funny, but just like stupid or like looking to start something. Like, it's you just, he was, look, he's asking for someone to react, right? And then he catches the reactions on video and they do react. And they don't react politely is the best way to phrase that.
And I would say that's his look aided in his intimidation too.
Oh, absolutely.
He had, you know, he was tatted up, he was fairly muscular, and he was staring aggressively. So he gave off that impression that he was looking to start a fight, which is no words.
He plays up what he looks like. He knows what he's doing. But again, he's just looking for reactions. But it's the same kind of thing. If you walk into a room and someone is staring at you the whole time, you might not throw them against the wall, but you're probably going to walk over and say, hello, do I know you? Can I help you? Yada, yada, yada. Just well, like that.
And that's an interesting psychology is when you see that, the person who's being stared at wants to break that silence.
Yeah.
Because there is making that contact non-verbally. You want to break it and find out what the heck is going on there.
Because someone's staring at you specifically.
Right.
All right. So what are some cultural differences with eye contact?
Yeah, this was just amazing to me. When you talk about like Western culture in general, that's some of the stuff we talked about was that unbreaking eye contact. You know, that seems to be definitely Western culture where that staring creates that almost overbearing or it's distracting to us because it's hitting us on like a subconscious level.
It comes off combative or just, yeah, combative is a good word.
And then like going into like traditional Islamic theology, They even speak about it in their theology about lowering one's gaze when speaking to people to avoid like sinful, sensuous appetites or desires. So they actually have discussion in their theology about not maintaining that because there is that level of attraction when you're maintaining eye contact with, I was going to say people of the opposite sex, but I guess it happens with
people of similar sexes. Yeah, they don't want to get lost in your eyes. That's not going to be an excuse that they're going to have. Which is interesting. I shouldn't say it's interesting, but that's something that we don't think about in Western civilization. We don't think about like, oh yeah, I'm going to get lost in your eyes. Like,
well, and so that's in Islamic theology. And the one thing that, and you see this a lot in respectful of like Japanese culture, and I didn't know this, but they were actually taught in school to gaze at somebody's Adam's apple, or they called it the tie knot, to never maintain that to their superiors. They referred to them as being their teacher. Mm-hmm. So they're never maintaining that. And then they would often lower their eyes when speaking to somebody that they consider superior. That's definitely a culture that has those classes of respect for people, either in classes or age or in, you know, reputation, that they show that respect by not maintaining that eye contact.
Right. It's the same kind of thing where if you are lower than them, I don't mean this in an offensive way, but like a dog, right? Like a dog would just like look down or whatever. It's the same kind of a thing. It doesn't need to be seen as any kind of a challenge to set other person's credibility or humanity. It's just a simple, like, no, I'll just look here.
Well, and with the eye contact, it was really amazing to me to see how it parallels with animals as well too. So we're very animalistic in our responses with eye contact as well too, with this nonverbal, to see the same responses in dogs. Dogs see it as aggressive to do eye contact, and then humans do as well too. It's just an interesting psychology that goes across all of these different barriers.
Yeah. No, that's cool. So what is the fear of eye contact called, James?
Okay. I'm going to give it a shot here. Okay. Scopophobia.
It is indeed. It is scopophobia. There's a fear of actually holding eye contact with somebody else.
So in that fear, is it of holding contact or even avoiding it
completely? It just says making eye contact. Like the fear of making eye contact is called scopophobia. So whether that's holding eye contact, just in general making eye contact, or looking at somebody's eyes directly or indirectly, is scopophobia.
And I know like on the autism, anywhere in the autism spectrum, Asperger's, all of those that commonly have that aversion to eye contact naturally, as well as Downs as well.
Yeah,
I believe.
Well, and it's one of those where they come off as culturally awkward, right? Like it's not normal behavior per se. And there's obviously reasons behind their actions. And one of the things that they just can't either focus on or can't hold is eye contact. It's just an easy little deal. I think that's actually a determining factor for babies too, is if you can hold their attention and or their eye contact.
And that's interesting.
Don't quote me on that one. I don't know that one for sure.
So Dr. Thompson, what is this psychology of baby eye contact?
I think they look at how well a baby can hold their focus or hold an eye contact as an early indicator or an early sign of certain things.
Well, and that's easy to catch even as a child. And I do think this is where we start going into, I do believe, like a lot of speaking, it's a practice. It's something mm-hmm. we can work on. It's something we can get better at. We're going to talk about some tips. But with that fear, I think also comes what is associated with it, which is that lack of confidence. Mm-hmm. When we lack confidence, lack that type of, maturity is not even the right word. When we lack the confidence, we're going to avoid that eye contact with somebody who we consider superior. So is that stuff that we learned as children? Is it something we learned culturally, or is it even something that's inborn in us that we have to develop that confidence to be able to look somebody in the eye? Because there is a lot on that psychology side too, that people will avert their eyes. Like when we talk about lying, mm-hmm. when we nonverbal, if you're trying to, we did, I think, a podcast on lie detection.
We did.
And when you go up and to the right, you're contemplating, you're thinking, you're using that side of your brain. Mm-hmm. But up and to the left is the indication of I'm making up a story.
Yeah.
So, but you're averting eye contact because you're not letting them in, but you're also physically doing those actions that are telling a story.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting. So you talk about confidence and looking down, right? You just got back from a Toastmaster speech, which is one of the things that they focus on in Toastmasters when giving a speech.
Eye contact.
Right. I got it. Mm-hmm. Right. So, because otherwise, I'm assuming they tell you that if you're staring down at your notes, you probably came unprepared and you're not willing, and you can't give a good speech, right?
And I will say this, during Dan Rex is the CEO of Toastmasters. He's here in Inglewood, is where Toastmasters is based worldwide. That guy gave his speech, and I just, for whatever reason, our group ended up in the front. Like, I am front row center looking up at the podium, which he didn't use, and he was in the center of the stage. And I guarantee you, we maintained eye contact for 2 or 3 seconds multiple times. Mm-hmm. It almost became a little intimidating when you're an audience member and you know, like, he did a great job of that. When I've spoken large audiences, I'll tend to span across. I don't tend to make an eye contact with an individual specifically, mm-hmm. but he did that and he did a great job of doing that. But it also, like, it's amazing the emotion you feel when, you know, here's the CEO of this, you know, gigantic, or nonprofit organization. Mm-hmm. He's making eye contact directly with me out of a room of 300-400 people.
I'm just saying. Then he knows you're paying attention or not. So you better not be the one caught staring at a phone while the CEO is giving a presentation.
Well, and that's part of it too. You're making eye contact to bring out that sincerity, the authenticity of it, and to say that you're speaking to them. But you're also doing that as a, to see if they're listening as well too. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah. Well, like I said, that's a perfect example. And it's the same kind of thing. I would be curious to see if people that do not make eye contact, like, or I should say people with scopophobia or just people in general that have an issue making eye contact also have an incredible fear of public speaking. Because we've already established that the fear of public speaking was, like, number one. Mm-hmm. And, like, death was number two, or spiders is number two, something like that.
I think spiders and death. Spiders. Or somehow you were unhappy with even that.
Well, I'm just spiders are more terrible. Well, no, death is more terrible. I think it was spiders. I think it was spiders. I think spiders, and then it was death. Anyway, we'll go back and listen to our podcast later. That way we can figure it all out. But that was the point, right? Is I'd be curious to see if maybe it's not necessarily, because if they were, like, looking down or looking at a specific point, right? Then they could have it. Or like actors. Have you ever watched an actor in an interview versus like an actor on mm-hmm. like in a movie or whatever? Johnny Depp, I think, was the first one that I ever noticed is him. You do an interview with him and he's terrible. Like I don't mean this in a bad way, but like he struggles to get out like full thoughts or full sentences mm-hmm. and there's a lot of ers and ums yeah. and he doesn't make direct eye contact.
Like, no, he fidgets a lot, he touches himself. Yeah.
And it's crazy how somebody that can make eye contact with like a camera, do a close up, deal with the entire production of a multi-million-dollar movie, and then you put them on, you know, like a set stage for a night news talk, whatever, and homie just can't even answer a simple question about what he just did.
Right. And I think you're on to that fact, maybe not just public speaking, but speaking publicly or to any individual. I think that eye aversion is there because you're not going to run into somebody who doesn't have eye contact that's going to speak for a long time. You know, you're not going to go up to them and they're not going to give a whole presentation for 30 minutes on, you know, the wonders of travel across the world because they're not going to do that, avoiding that eye contact, because that's not going to be that individual talking for that long either.
Mm-hmm. And it's hard to, you know, that would just be, I would be curious to see how many people that have, if scopophobia. I'm pretty sure that all the people that have scopophobia also have a fear of public speaking. Yeah. I don't think there's anybody that can ever like look down the whole time that they're giving a public speech and have it work out.
Right. The one thing I did want to bring up first, look up Tim Ferriss. Tim Ferriss wrote the book, The 4-Hour Workweek.
Okay.
Sounds like a brilliant idea.
Sure. Sounds great.
He also had a podcast. He's written several books. Some of his stuff is very motivational in trying to invest and take risks and some other things. But he talks about have this challenge of, because we all are not great at eye contact, and especially if you're not, focus and purpose on a day to go out and maintain eye contact with every individual that you go with longer than you would normally feel comfortable. So you're kind of stretching yourself. Right. So you're doing that and then see the effect it has on people, because it will engage people more. It will engage when a better conversation, you're going to get more out of doing it, and you have to stretch yourself in that zone. So I suggest doing that. But the first one is really make eye contact before you start talking. So before you just roll into it, don't be staring off into the ether.
Yeah, just staring off over here in the bunker. Anyway.
But to make eye contact before you start talking, before you utter any words, just establish that begins the connection, and it, you know, then you start talking that face to face. So yeah. That's tip number one, is to do that before you start having your conversation.
Right. So then at least then they know, or you've engaged them, and then you don't necessarily need to make eye contact the rest of the time. Which it's quality. That's actually a really good idea. Just that way, the initial engagement's there, and then from that, because I mean, we just analyzing our conversation now, we don't make eye contact probably 30% of the time, I'd say, give or take,
yeah,
whatever it is. Right? But like the initial, the initial is there, and then after that, you can move on to whatever you're doing.
Well, and I worked with a guy. He had a wonky eye. They call it. He's just it
was kind of like a lazy eye.
But he would start talking, and I didn't know that he was talking to me. If there's two people here, he would kind of always tip his head a little bit, because mm-hmm. I think he was looking at me with the one good eye, but the other eye was out looking at the other guy, and I didn't know. So it does initiate and start that conversation. So it is really good advice.
Yeah.
Number two, hold your gaze for 4 to 5 seconds at a time. So you're not saying the whole time. Just don't stare him down.
No, you don't want to just. So, and this is, we talked about Doug, right? With this sales ship, and he doesn't break focus. It's you the whole time. He doesn't really move his head very much. He doesn't interrupt you the entire time you're talking, like nothing. He just holds it and goes. And you don't have to do that. You can only just make eye contact quick, right? It's like a re-up every single time, like you kind of make eye contact with somebody. They're like, all right. Are you still paying attention? Yeah, I'm still paying attention. We're going to go. So just that 4 to 5 seconds, just to know that you're engaged, they're engaged, and then to move forward with it.
I would love to, now that we're talking about this, have another conversation with him, because we used his example in empathetic listening, mm-hmm. because he is so engaged in that conversation.
Yeah.
And I think that eye contact is the other thing, is if somebody's making eye contact with you longer than you're used to, you're going to stay in there.
Yeah.
You're not going to get distracted. It's like, hey, I'm over here. We're talking about, I'm selling you something.
Yeah.
And that is another way to maintain that conversation as well, too.
Yeah.
Like if you're bored in your conversation, I've been there.
I was like, yeah.
Other people get bored too.
Yeah, no, it happens. I understand. So you just look away, you fidget with something else, but then it's always again, just re-up it, right?
Yeah.
We have a less of an attention span than a goldfish.
Which is amazing.
Yeah. Those, yeah.
I love those little crackers.
They are great.
They're delicious.
Yeah. And they're not magically delicious. That's the wrong catchphrase.
No, correct.
Anyway, as you were saying.
So the next one is to use gestures. Mm-hmm. That I think is interesting in tips for maintaining eye contact. But, you know, as we were talking earlier before the podcast, like when you talk about newscasters, a newscaster doesn't just stare in there,
no.
But they don't make a lot of gestures. But when we're having our conversations, it's okay to do that, especially if you feel uncomfortable with just maintaining that eye contact. You know, you can look away, you can use your hands. I have found though a couple of times that if I see a squirrel or something, I actually was having a conversation with a guy. He literally saw a squirrel mm-hmm. outside of our office, but he looked away. What do you do when somebody looks away?
Do you do the same thing?
Yes. And I've been talking to somebody and somebody will be in the background. I'm looking to your, you know, to your right. Mm-hmm. I'll look and they'll stop looking at me and go look over that way. Yeah. When it just was whatever it was, a dog crossed the street or something. We follow those eyes. So we are maintaining and tracking that.
Well, I was like, and then gestures also just help. It makes them look at your hands as opposed to necessarily looking at you. So if you have anxiety about eye contact, gestures are a good way for you to be able to 4 to 5 seconds do something here, so that way they can maybe look at your hand, look at your shoulders, look somewhere else that's not straight at your eyes.
Yeah, it allows some freedom for that type of break.
Right? Yeah, it's a natural break. It comes honestly. It's, again, you were discussing newscasts, right? They don't want it to be distracting from them because, again, they're the face of the franchise. They're the whole thing. They're delivering you the news. So they don't want crazy, or they don't want like crazy head bobs or just like, you know, doing the whole thing or crazy hand gestures that go wide, but shoulder shrugs, head nods, side to side, small things with their hands. So it just go watch nightly news and see what they do with their hands and their shoulders. Just, I will say that.
Yeah. When you, and I hadn't done that before, when you really look at the nightly news and then focus on it, you see how much they've practiced being natural.
Yeah.
Like they put a lot of work in there
and to be on the screen still naturally
and look natural.
Yeah.
Even though they're putting work into it, which really the second one kind of ties into it too, which is moving your eyes slowly. You don't want to dart around. You ever heard the word shifty eyes? You don't want to be the shifty eyed guy, but that's what the recommendation is too. Cause you don't want to dart your eyes somewhere. Cause then what's that person going to do? Go look at that squirrel that you just got distracted by.
Okay, cause again, cause it makes you look like you're thinking you're processing something different when your eyes are darting in and out all the time. And that's not what you're trying to do. You're just, you know, looking at something different.
Yeah, I'm just fatigued at looking at your face.
Yeah, it's exhausting.
Now, the last one, this is interesting. Like, what is the right amount of eye contact for us to have a healthy conversation?
So the number or the percentages that they give is 50 to 70% of the time. I think it's a little high, but it's also not a bad number either. I think about 50% would probably be the standard. If you're having a more serious conversation, eye contact is probably not a better idea. But in all reality, when you move to a different subject or you come back to something or whatever, like you can break eye contact, but then to reinitiate that conversation or to reinitiate like the connection with that person, just make eye contact again. That doesn't have to mean that when you go on like a long diatribe or soliloquy, right, that you're maintaining eye contact the whole time. That's going to come off as intimidating. But you just want to, like, it's almost like a check-in, like make eye contact almost as like a check-in to what's going on.
Well, and you were talking about that 30%, which I think is pretty accurate. You know, we've got, if we were to have show notes and we were actually reading something, we're looking at those things, looking at the screen, we're doing different things. So we're not necessarily in that. We're like really focused on it today. I feel like we're making a great connection.
It's almost like we're talking about exactly what we're trying to do. We're now knowledgeable of it. So then we're going to continue to do it. Yeah. Well, it's like when you call somebody out on something and then they're just like, oh, I can't say that word or I can't do that one thing that always does that. When you become self-conscious, we became self-conscious of our eye contact today, James. So now we have made an effort to make more eye contact.
That's exactly it. But that percentage, when you talked about having serious conversation and maintaining that eye contact, I've had lots of serious conversations with individuals at work. And what's interesting about that is when that eye contact breaks, like they're staring down at the ground, you're staring down at the ground, and you've lost that eye contact, because those are for really hard conversations. That's something that I'm going to go back and kind of replay, because when that happens, I think there might be that break in that connection and that relationship as well, too, because those are hard conversations to have, and somebody doesn't want to maintain that eye contact. Well, so maybe the tip to the uncommon communicator is if somebody's having that hard conversation with them, lean into it. Like, just put your hand on your chin and just shake your head while they're giving you those words of reprimand.
Well, it's also hard too, because you can sometimes, in order to say what you need to say, you just can't hold eye contact, right? Like, it's just a hard conversation to have. So having that very intimate connection, dare I say, is just difficult to do. So I will say the other pro tip that I have is if you can't look at their eyes, look at their nose, look at their mouth, look at their ears, or like the rims of their glasses. It looks like eye contact. It very much does. It is hard for the other person to notice where you're looking. So if you need to be looking at somebody the entire time, that's a good spot. As you were saying, in Asian cultures, right? The tie knot or the mouth, same kind of thing. I wouldn't say dart your eyes in between all of them, but look at an ear, look at a nose, look at a mouth, see what that does and notice how it doesn't really change where your eyes go, especially depending on where the distance is that you're at.
Yeah, and I think that tie knot does give you a little bit down, but when we practice that a little bit earlier, that's an absolutely great pro tip of if you're in a standard conversation 5-6 feet away and you're maintaining just the gigantic head that you have, I have plenty of space for me to look at where you think I'm maintaining eye contact.
Right. So you're not coming off as disrespectful, but you're still engaged. But again, if you can't have that connection specifically, just look away, but don't look away. Just look somewhere else.
Well, in closing, I did have one question for you.
Okay. What about the eye roll?
Well, we're talking about eye contact.
Okay.
Sometimes I've caught people rolling their eyes, and I don't think they knew that I was seeing their disagreements with what I was saying. Is that something that you should really watch for? Or do you think they were wanting to telegraph that type of disinterest in my conversation?
I mean, either way, if they don't vocalize it, it's a good thing that you caught it. Because then you just know. I mean, I'll eye roll all the time. I'll let you know right away.
Just right there.
Yeah.
You're not even going to waste any words on it. You're going to roll the eye.
And just call it a day. There's going to be and they're just going to move on.
But as we're wrapping this up, I think we got some great tips on maintaining that eye contact, really understanding how important eye contact is in all of our conversations, which is about being an uncommon communicator. What do you think is really the UC moment for today?
But eye contact is a connection that gets made first. It's the first connection. Eyes are the first connection.
I like it.
Yeah. Eye contact is the first connection you make.
I think I'm out of words.
All right. So am I.
That's all I got.
See you back. Eye contact. Have to make eye contact before you say that. That is true.